I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb, yeah, till I met you. You called my name, come on, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. Now your mercy has saved my soul. Your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, yeah, Jesus, when I met you. Who, when you called my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. When you call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
About your story, think about when you first met Christ.
I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that
praise the name of Jesus Christ. He's the one who rescued us. If you're here this morning and you know Christ and you're a little hyper this morning because of that, say, uh-huh. All right. And maybe you're here this morning and you don't know Christ. That's okay. We're glad you guys are here. Our desire as you come around those who know Christ, and as you come and you let the walls down out of your heart, as you let those down, as you just open up to Christ, because there's a reason you're here today. I don't know if you know that, but God has you here for a specific reason. So I hope before you leave today, you'll be able to make that decision and step one step towards Christ. But we're glad you guys are here. My name is Rob. I'm the worship pastor here, and we're going to look forward to a great day. Why don't we sit down and check out this video, all right?
A lot of guys have a preconceived idea about what happens at a men's retreat.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Okay, guys, for the next exercise, everybody find a partner. All right, Jeff, this is the trust fall. Just trust that Gary's gonna catch you. Release your fears and go when you're ready. Just release your fears and go. Ah! Guys, this has been a great week. I think we should close in prayer and hold hands.
Listen, I promise it's not going to be that bad. In fact, I bet you'll have an awesome time. This year, we have special guest Vietnam veteran Tim Lee coming to minister to us. I hope you'll join us on November 3rd and 4th at the Refreshing Mountain Retreat Center in Pennsylvania. To find out more or to register, go to our events page on the Lifehouse app, our website, or visit us on Facebook. Sign up today.
How's everybody doing today? Well, my name is Joel Miller, and I'm one of the pastors here at Lifehouse Church. Men, you do not want to miss our retreat on November 3rd through 4th. Last year, we had 54 guys attend, and this year, we're inviting high schoolers and up to come with us. Space is limited, so sign up for the Ironman Retreat today. You can do that on our app or on our website. Also, our baptism celebration is today. If you want to take part in believers' baptism, please see one of our pastors following the service. Lunch will start at 1 p.m., followed by fellowship, inflatables, and volleyball. The baptism will start at 3 p.m. If you do not want to bring a picnic lunch, you can purchase a meal ticket on the Lifehouse app under signups. Guests are free, and also please bring your own lawn chairs. Next Sunday, we're having a baby dedication. If you'd like to participate, please email us or see one of the pastors after the service. And then we are excited to announce that we're sending a missions team on a trip to our sister church in Haiti this upcoming February 2nd through 9th. And if you don't know, we partnered with a church there earlier this year. And while we go on this trip, we're gonna assist in renovating their church building, building some water filters, and teaching some Bible and leadership classes. Now, if you can swing a hammer or carry supplies or have any experience with building and construction, then this would be a great trip for you. We're looking for about 7 guys that can do that. But maybe you can't swing a hammer, maybe you've never had any construction experience, but you'd like to come and help. We still have a spot for you too. We're looking for about 5 to 7 people that can do relational ministry, help with kids, talk with people, establish relationships, pray. So this trip is kind of for everybody. And then if you're interested, we'll have a meeting in the library following the second service next Sunday, just to kind of give more information about that. And then finally, next Sunday is also Connect Sunday. So if you're new to Lifehouse, our staff would like to meet you, share our history and our vision, direction the church is going on. So you can ask questions during that time, and you can learn how to connect here at Lifehouse Church. We'll meet at 12:30 in the library. Lunch and childcare is provided.
And let's just pray right where you're at before we continue in worship. Just close your eyes and examine your heart for the next few minutes. And I want you to ask the Lord if there's anything in there that shouldn't be, to bring it to your attention. It says he knows your heart. He knows your thoughts. And he knows you more than you know yourself. So let's clear our hearts. Let's clear our minds this morning as we continue in worship.
Thank you.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only wanna hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we wanna know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. Come speak to us, Lord.
Sing that together.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only wanna hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we wanna know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. And when you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we seek and what we see. Changes everything. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we're leaning into all you are. Everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living now and breathe upon our hearts. Come now and have your way. 'Cause when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. And when you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. You're changing everything. When you move all our fear. And when you move us to tears. Yes, you do. And when you move all our fears. And when you move us to tears. And when you hanging on every word. Jesus living within us, never to fail or forsake. Unending promise, heaven inside us, whispers the sound of your.
Lord, Father, Teacher, Comforter, the true living God, the I Am, who was and is and always will be, Jesus. God, we thank you for who you are, for the many names and characters that you are. Lord, all the attributes that you are. Lord, you are everything. You are everything good and just. Lord, as we offer ourselves, God, would you work? Would you show us more and more and more as we take those little steps of faith? Show us more. You're a light to our path. So God, help us to not worry about the horizon, but just worry about you taking control. And so, Lord, as we worship you through music and now through giving and just a little bit through your holy word, God, would you be blessed? In Jesus' name, amen. You could be seated. We want to welcome our first-time guests here who are here for the very first time. We're glad you guys are here. Thank you for coming. And before you leave today, we have a special gift for you and your family. If you go out the doors, take a look to your left. You'll see a big sign that says Connect. That's for you guys. We have a free gift on that table. You can just grab one and get out if you want to get out. If you want to hang out, that's cool too. We'll be available up front. But the ushers are coming forward right now, and I'd like for you to raise your hand in just a little bit and get one of these cards, fill it out. Then you can drop it in the offering basket, which is going to go by in a couple minutes from right now. And then basically that'll just give us an idea who is here. If you have any questions, maybe you have something, a prayer request that you'd like a pastor to follow you up with, we can do that. That's what that card is there for, all right? So so feel free to put information down right there. We're not going to sell your information or anything like that. It'll stay right here, I promise. But we're glad you guys are here. If this is you, if this is your very first time to Lifehouse, would you mind raising your hand up real high to get one of these cards? Raise them up, guys. We're glad you're here. Church, let's welcome these guys to church. Thanks for coming, man.
Good morning. So I am privileged to have the opportunity to talk to you before we take up our offering this morning. My name is Tammy Lacey, and I'm Mark's wife, and I'm a partner here at Lifehouse Church. And it's a privilege and an honor to talk about giving, because God has just really taught myself and my family his generous heart that he has for us. And of course, there's many ways to give. You can give through the app or text to give or use the kiosk in the lobby, or you can use the offering basket this morning as it's passed. But as I prayed about what God would have me share, because there's a lot of things I'd love to say about what it's like to trust God with giving, God gave me a verse, and it's 1 Timothy 6:6, and it says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." And the verse is basically saying, seeking to live God's way while being content is great gain. And a story is told of a king in a great land who had everything. He wasn't, even though he had everything that he wanted, he wasn't content. And he told his men to go out into the land and to find the happiest man, the most contented man they could find, and that they were to bring back his shirt so that he could wear it, hoping that if he wore his shirt, he would find himself with the same contentedness. So the men went out, and they looked everywhere, and they found this man, and they returned to the king. And the king asked, "Did you find the man?" And they said, "Yes, we did." And he said, "Well, where's the shirt?" And they told him he didn't have one. That story has just really spoken to my heart in so many ways, because you know, when we learn about giving, one of the characteristics that I think is very important in giving is the characteristic of contentedness. And when we're content, we say that God is my portion, that God will provide. All that I have comes from his hand, and he provides all I need. My parents were really good examples of living with contentedness. I never felt like they were vying for more, and there were even times that they were content to do without the latest and the greatest thing. They taught me from a very early age to give back to God. And I would get a quarter when I was a kid. And in that day, it seemed like a decent allowance. So it was like 10 years ago. But anyway, my mom would tell me to tithe on this quarter. Now do the math in that. That's not easy. But she'd always encourage to give a little more if you have to. Always give a little more. And so I learned that. And you know what? This was a gift to me. They always taught me to entrust God with all that I had. And it was just such a treasure that I've carried with me throughout my life. I have been blessed to teach the same example to my kids, because we find when we look at the verse, godliness with contentment is great gain. I looked up the word gain in the original text in the Greek, and the word says a providing. Think about that. Godliness, seeking God's way, doing God's way with contentment that he has you in his hand and in his care, brings a providing. It's a providing to us. I'm so glad it's in his hands and not in my own hands. So I want to ask you a question as we get ready to take the offering. It can be difficult to be generous when we forget God's promises to provide. And I just want to ask you, where's your heart today? Are you content? Are you generous? The example we live out, we pass on. In fact, would your family or your children say that you're content? As you consider what you'll give this morning, today and every day, I want you to ask, let's ask God to teach us to be content in him. Let's ask God to give us a heart of contentedness. Let's pray. God, we are so thankful for your goodness. You promise to provide. You promise that you will supply all our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ. And God, because we have Christ in our lives, we have all things, God. He is so good to us. And so, Lord, I pray that you would speak to a heart this morning to what I shared, that they would understand that you're wanting them to trust you with what they have, to give back, to know that you will take good care of all the things they place in your hand. God, just move in this time, and I pray that this offering will be blessed and will bring you glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Light appeared from nothing. Oh, light appeared from nothing. With the Spirit brooding over waters, heaven meets earth. From night then came the morning. From night then came the morning. There was sky in the middle of the water. Heaven meets earth. The sun revealed your beauty. The sun revealed your beauty. Every mountain bowing down before you, and heaven meets earth. Creation sings your glory. Creation sings your glory. Hallelujah's rising in the daylight, and heaven meets earth. Oh, holy, 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 holy. Holy.
holy, 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 holy are you, Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Spirit. Mighty to save, strong to redeem, creator, sustainer, provider, redeemer, lover of our souls. Who are we that you are even mindful of us? And not only you are mindful of us, oh God, you love us. God, I pray that you would do what only you can do this morning, oh God. Would you move in a way, Lord, that would blow us away? Oh God, I pray that we would stand in awe of you, in awe of your glory. God, that is what I seek this morning. Your glory, not our glory, not the glory of Lifehouse Church. Lord, your glory. We want to see your glory. We believe that you are who you reveal yourself to be. We believe that all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to you. And so, Lord, I as your servant submit to you. And I believe your word has the power to save. The gospel is the power of God for salvation to anyone who would believe. Everyone who calls upon your name shall be saved. And, oh God, I pray that that would take place this morning. Do what only you can do. I pray for fruit, the fruit of your glory. And I pray this in Jesus' name, the name above all names. Amen. 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 Would you be seated? Wow, holy, holy, holy. Holy. Please turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 3, where we'll read verses 14 through 21 in a moment. This passage is a prayer, a beautiful prayer. A fervent prayer to the Father for fullness and for fruit. It's the fervent prayer of a servant of God, the Apostle Paul, for the church. And I'll explain to you a little bit more about the context that leads into this prayer in a moment. We'll break it down in a moment like we do here at Lifehouse Church. But let's read together Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. Paul says, for this reason. And again, we'll look at that reason in a moment. Paul has a very good reason, but he says, for this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory, that he may grant you, church, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ, Jesus Christ, may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have the strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And now to him who is able, to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or even think, according to the power, his power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. This morning is a special day. It's the birthday of our sister church, Lifehouse Smyrna. Can you believe it's been 1 year? This morning, Pastor Drew Matthews is preaching a sermon on this very passage, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21, to the body of believers there, our brothers and sisters in Christ there, as they celebrate all that God has done and is doing in and through them in 1 year. Can you believe it's been a year? A year ago, we sent them. Our brothers and sisters, a year ago, right here, I did the ugly cry, as Rob put it, in front of all of you, right where I'm standing, as we commissioned them to go and do what God called them to do. Anyone else remember the ugly cry? How could you forget the ugly cry? A year ago, we released them. And it was hard, wasn't it? In many ways, we did not want to let them go. I didn't want to let them go. We sent some of our very, very best. Men and women who were so faithful and are so faithful. Men and women who were so generous, so talented people. Men and women that we love dearly. People that labored with us. They strive side by side with us in the trenches of ministry. We let go and release people that encouraged us. A year ago, this Sunday, the first Sunday in October, seats in this auditorium that were always faithfully filled with loving and supportive brothers and sisters in Christ, seats in this auditorium that were filled week after week, sat empty. Hope I don't do the ugly cry again. For the first time. And there was a void here. And it was hard, wasn't it? I cried for weeks, both leading up to and after. I'm still crying. I still get a little choked up about it. Nevertheless, God has been so faithful, and I feel it is very appropriate for us to celebrate with them. And I want to thank you, Lifehouse Church, Lifehouse MOT. I want to make sure that you know that in many ways, because of what you did and do here and how you give here, that God is at work here and there. As we Lifehouse, we support them, we invest financially, yes, but even more beyond that, they are so encouraged by your prayers and your gifts and your support. So as we watch this video, we're going to watch a video recapping their year. Know that you played a role in what we're watching and everything that's taken place and everything that will take place in the days, months, and years to come. And know that some of the men and women that you will see in that video prior to the launch of Lifehouse Church a month ago, or a year ago rather, in Smyrna, we're not worshiping God. And prior to the launch of Lifehouse Church, many of the men and women and children that are in that video were not saved. They were not growing spiritually, but they have been able to do so because of your gifts, because of your service, and because we released them to do what God has called them to do. So be encouraged and realize that in the launching and support of that church in that town, you have been and are a part of more. Building the kingdom of God for his glory. Let's watch the video and be blessed.
So today we will be commissioning a team of missionaries, including myself and my family, to go down the road to Smyrna to advance the gospel in that community.
And only had just one glimpse. We've tasted of your glory, but there's so more. We're standing on horizons where earth collides with heaven. You're longing for your children to cry out for more.
Let it rain.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. Amen. Praise his holy name. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge and remind you what will begin next week. Actually, this week, October 7th, this Saturday, we'll begin our Saturday evening services here in this auditorium at Lifehouse. And I want to remind you that our motivation to do so is not for the convenience of our congregation in any way, shape, or form, but rather, like launching Lifehouse Smyrna, it's to reach people that aren't being reached right now. My hope is that this opportunity will catalyze gospel growth in the streets of our town. And listen, I am quite well aware that this is a step of faith for us. I am well aware that this will involve sacrifice. For us, it will cost us a lot, and it means that seats that are filled in this auditorium here this morning by men and women that we love next Sunday morning will be empty. Nevertheless, I trust and I pray that in time, men and women that right now are not worshiping God will worship God because of it. And I pray that men and women who are far from God in sin and not saved will come to know Jesus and be saved, and they will grow spiritually. Listen, I've received wonderful feedback from the community, people that don't even attend this church. I just want to share a few comments with you regarding the Saturday evening service. One woman wrote, and their quote should be on the screen. She wrote, "I'm so grateful that you're adding a Saturday evening service. I suffer from fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, severe back pain, and so much more. It's almost impossible to get to church by the time needed. I have been trying to find a church with my beliefs that have evening services for years. Thank you. I look forward to meeting with you." Another woman wrote, "The opportunity, or opening the opportunity for a Saturday service, provides us, our family, with the ability to go to church as a family. My husband works on Sundays. Thank you." Another wrote, "I'm unable to attend Sunday services, so I am very excited about the Saturday evening services. My son attends the youth group and speaks so highly of Lifehouse." Listen, there are so many more, but don't these quotes, don't these messages, unsolicited messages from the community, excite you, Lifehouse Church? People that are seeking God, who want to learn and grow? And this is just a sampling. I'm telling you, we could be here all morning reading the comments and having and sharing with you the conversations that we've had. God is at work. He is drawing people to himself. And so we here at Lifehouse Church are going to lift him up, magnify him, make much of him, proclaim the gospel, and trust him to do the rest in the lives of our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers, our family, and he is going to be glorified. Amen? Brothers and sisters, let's pray for fruit. Remember, pray, participate, and promote. Let's trust and watch God do what only he can do and trust him every step of the way. Do you understand that God has been working here and among us 5.5 years? Can you believe what God has done? I mean, I'm telling you, when we stepped out 5.5 years ago and planted this church, I had no idea what God would do. When I read what Paul said in Corinthians, "No eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagine the things that God has prepared for those who love him," this is what it is. People, when they step out in obedience because they love Jesus, and when they do what God has called them to do, and they are who God has created them to be, this is what we get: fruit, God glorifying fruit. God is glorified. And I'm just praying for more. God is at work here and now. Did you hear what happened at our youth ministry last Tuesday night? I'm telling you what, revival happened. God showed up. The Spirit of God moved. Our teens, boys and girls, were saved. Some rededicated and recommitted their lives, repented of sin, and committed to step out in faith. All the leaders were crying. Malcolm Venata was doing the ugly cry, but that's no surprise to us, right? Brian Canalongo told me that he was even crying, and he says, "I never cry." I mean, it was amazing. The Spirit showed up. Can I get a witness for all who were there? Right? It was amazing. Today, this afternoon, God is at work in and among us, Lifehouse Church. Who are we that he is even mindful of us? Men and women and children who have been saved here and because of this ministry will obediently declare, boldly declare their saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ through baptism, communicating that they believe the gospel in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that they have a heart to follow him and live for him. And it's not too late. If you are a believer and you have not been baptized by immersion, you need to do so. It's my conviction based on Scripture. My understanding is that if you're not, as a believer, and you have not been, then you are being disobedient. And I get the reasons. I've heard all the excuses for not getting baptized, but just for a moment, may I humbly and lovingly tell you and hear my heart in this. None of the reasons that I've heard are good reasons for people not doing what God has commanded us to do in Scripture. And I don't want to force anybody to do it. I don't want to coerce anybody to do what God has told them to do. I don't want to guilt anyone into it. Hear my heart here. I simply want people to honor God. I want people to be blessed as they follow Jesus in and through baptism. I want God to bless them because I believe God blesses obedience. That's what these shirts are about. So if you want to get baptized today, see me after the service. That's all I'll say about it. In Ephesians 3, 14 through 20, we see, again, a fervent prayer to the Father for fullness and for fruit. This fervent prayer was written by a servant of God. It was a prayer for a church, although in a completely different context, not unlike us here and now in many ways. A body of believers in the city of Ephesus, which is located in modern-day Turkey. Paul planted that church. God sent him there, and because Paul was obedient, he always went where he was sent. Ephesus was a strategic city. It was a hub for so many things, but for the gospel when Paul planted the church. Paul's first experience in the city of Ephesus is recorded in Acts chapter 18. It was very brief. Like, he was literally just passing through the city on his way back to Jerusalem. The Spirit was leading him to go back. He had gone into the synagogue of the Jews, which is his standard operating procedure, and shared with them about Jesus, that the Messiah was here, salvation was available. They need not wait. They need not look any longer. Jesus was here and now, and if they called upon his name, they could be saved. Many of them likely did so. But he was just passing through. He did, however, leave two of his partners in ministry behind. Remember Aquila and Priscilla, the businessmen, the tent makers? And thus the church in the city of Ephesus was born. Well, not long after, Paul circled back after his trip to Jerusalem, back to the city of Ephesus in Acts chapter 19, and he engaged, if you'll remember, some quote-unquote disciples who were not really disciples. There's a lot of those in this day and age, too. Remember, he had asked them point blank, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you first believed? And they said, we did not even know that there was a Holy Spirit. So the answer is no. Well, Paul shared with them that there was a Holy Spirit, and likely he shared with them what Jesus shared with Nicodemus, that unless you're born again, born of the Spirit, you cannot even see the kingdom of God. Long story short, they believed. They called upon the name of Jesus. They were saved, so they received the Holy Spirit. And we're told that immediately, Acts chapter 19, 5, on hearing about Jesus and placing their faith in just in Jesus, on hearing, they believed and were baptized. They didn't wait. I said I wasn't going to say anything more about that. Guess I did. From that point forward, the church in Ephesus, because people were obedient, God blesses obedience, amen. It exploded. The church in Ephesus thrived despite opposition, and there was a lot of opposition, if you'll remember. Despite persecution, despite obstacles, the enemy was not happy about what was going on in Ephesus, and so he put many barriers, but God broke down those barriers. Paul spent 3 years there teaching and making disciples, teaching them everything that Jesus had commanded, and not just in Ephesus, but even the other cities around Ephesus. God was doing, we're told, extraordinary miracles in Ephesus because God's people were obedient in Ephesus. By the hands of Paul, his servant, the name of Jesus, we are told, was extolled there, and the word of God, we're told, increased and prevailed mightily during those 3 years of ministry because God's people were obedient. A church was born, and the church grew. Jesus, what he said was true. Remember, he said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. But then after time, the Spirit was leading Paul to go back to Jerusalem. He was constrained by the Spirit to leave the church that he loved and the people that he loved, to go back to Jerusalem, and it was hard for them to leave. He loved them, and they loved him. When he departed from the Ephesians, we're told that there was much weeping. They were doing some ugly crying when Paul left Ephesus. You can read it in the Bible, so I'm not alone. That makes me feel a little bit better. Fast forward a few years, and Paul writes this very church, the people that he loved, a letter to the Ephesians. It's a very personal letter, understand. This is a heartfelt love letter. This is not religious rigmarole. That's not what this letter is about. That's not what this fervent prayer was about. This is not liturgy. This is a heartfelt, very personal letter from a man who deeply loved God and deeply loved the people that he was writing to, wanting more for them, not wanting them to settle for anything less than God's best, not wanting them to miss out on a thing that God had for them and their purpose in him. So he wrote them a letter, people in whom and through whom God had already incredibly worked and mightily worked. In this letter, Paul, leading up to this prayer, reminds them who they are as believers and as a church, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. They are that together. And he's burdened because he loves God and loves them deeply for them to do what God created them to do and to be who God created them to be. I think we can all agree that the church today in general has a bad rap. People blame the quote-unquote church or a church or some church out there from their past or that they heard about one time, or that they made up in their mind, let's be honest, for their personal spiritual waywardness. They blame the church, a church, for their personal disobedience. But Paul, again, and this is not spiritual liturgy, this is not religious hubbub, this is truth, writes in this letter that it is through the church, God's church, the bride of Christ, the body of Christ, and to be quite frank, not a parachurch organization, not isolated individuals doing their own thing, not hipster musicians that wear skinny jeans, although God does use all those things, he can use anything, anybody. But it's through the church. Brothers and sisters, before we read Paul's fervent prayer to the Father for fullness and for fruit, I want to tell you what he tells the people he loves in Ephesians 3:10. If you have your Bibles, open it there, read with me. He says, speaking of the gospel, which is the power of God for salvation, speaking that incredibly salvation is available to all, not just the Jewish people, but even the Ephesians, Greek Ephesians, people that they thought were just way beyond the reach of God, that God sent Jesus to save us from sin, death, and hell. And he said, this is a mystery. I get it. This sounds too good to be true. This is amazing. But he said, that reality is a mystery. It is above us. The opportunity, the gospel, Jesus and salvation. Paul says, it is through the church that this mystery, this amazing reality, this truth, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known. Through the church, that is. He goes on to say, this is God's plan. This is God's purpose for your church, Ephesians. And I would wholeheartedly say to you, Delawareans, this is God's plan and purpose for your church. Paul acknowledges that living out the purpose, making known the gospel, the manifold wisdom of God involves and will involve sacrifice and perhaps suffering. He tells them to not give up. Later, he says, don't lose heart. It's going to be hard. I know it's going to be hard as you do what God called you to do. And so Paul, who deeply loves them, in light of all this, prays a fervent prayer to the Father for fullness and for fruit. He says in verse 14, for this reason, in light of God's purpose and plan for you, church, because God's plan and purpose for you, church, corporately, church, body of Christ, church, the vessel through which he intended to make the mystery, the gospel known, that salvation is here and now, and knowing it will be hard, knowing that there will be opposition, knowing that when you put people in the mix, there'll be problems in the mix, things to work through, things to trust God's for this reason, Paul says, I bow my knees. This is a fervent prayer, brothers and sisters. This is not willy-nilly, rub-a-dub-dub, thank God for the grub. This is not procedural, ritualistic prayer. This is desperate prayer. This is heartfelt prayer. This is the prayer, the cry of the Apostle Paul, who loved God with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength. This is his heart's cry for the people that he loved. When's the last time you bowed your knees in prayer? When you got on your knees and prayed to Almighty God and there cried for him to do what only he can do. If you've ever been there, you know it was because you were desperate. Perhaps you didn't go there voluntarily, but you encountered God or you were so desperate that you fell to your knees and there cried out to God and he answered. He did there for me and he does there for me and he will do there for you. This. What I want you to understand is this prayer is a knee-worthy request. What he's asking God to do is knee-worthy. This is what only God can do. One day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. But I choose to bow now, and I know that many of you do as well. But we're told in James chapter 5 that the fervent prayer, and that's the kind of prayer this is, of a righteous man, someone who is in Christ, avails much. It's profitable. It's worthwhile for you to pray and for you to pray fervently on your knees to cry your hearts out to God. Paul knew that, and so Paul prayed a lot for that reason, but here for this reason, in Ephesians chapter 3, we see him on his knees praying to the Father. Praying to the one true God who hears and answers, who is able, the one from whom every good and perfect gift is, present tense, coming down, James chapter 1, the one from whom, through whom, and to whom are all things, Romans chapter 11, 36, Paul knew and believed what Jesus says. Remember in Luke 11 when he was talking about prayer? He said, you know, he's using the parable, the illustration of going to your neighbor at midnight because you knock on their door because you need some bread, and he's saying that neighbor will ignore the knock, but he's saying God's not like that. And he says, what father, if a son asks for a fish, will give his son a snake? God's not like that. He's a good father. And Jesus says that we are to ask and it will be given unto you. He says that we are to seek and you will find. He says not because it's God on the other side of the door waiting to hear from his children. That door will be opened to you. Thus saith the Lord Jesus Christ, who always tells us the truth. For this reason, Paul bows his knees. And for this reason, he does so to the Father, verse 15, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. In other words, our creator, our sustainer. That's who we bow to. That's who Paul bowed to, and to his son, Jesus Christ, the one to whom all authority in heaven and earth has been given. And furthermore, who because of him, we can even pray and approach God's throne. Hebrews 4:16, we can boldly approach the throne of grace in prayer and find grace to help in our time of need. We don't have to wait for an appointment next Sunday with the pastor. We can go anywhere, anytime, and we can get to God through Jesus Christ. And he longs to hear us and answer our prayers. Paul prays to God the Father, verse 16, because he is able. And he says that according to the riches of his glory, which are inexhaustible, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being. In other words, that his Spirit in your heart will encourage you from the inside out. In other words, that the rivers of living water will flow from your heart that Jesus talked about. Verse 17, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Now understand here, he's not talking about salvation. These people are already saved. They're the church. Can't be a part of the church, the body of Christ, unless you have the Spirit of God living in your heart. The Spirit of God knits believers together in the church. So these are already believers. He's writing to the church in Ephesus. But what's this verse 17? So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. This goes beyond salvation right here. This dwelling, does Christ dwell in your heart, believer? Brother and sister in Christ, I'm talking dwell. Dwell, the Greek word that Paul used, means not just to be present. It means to set up shop. It means to rule and reign. It means to sit on the throne of your heart. It means to abide in your heart. That's the kind of dwelling Paul's praying for, that he's trusting God to do in the hearts of these believers. What's the case with you, believer? Does Christ dwell in your heart? He can. Does he rule and reign in your heart? Or have you kicked him off the throne? Have you shoved him out the door, off into the side? Paul prayed that these believers who were saved, in whom God had worked mightily, had done amazing things. He prayed. He said, I bow my knees to the Father that Christ, Jesus Christ, may abide, may rule and reign in your heart, may be the authority in your life. And furthermore, that you being rooted and grounded, as opposed to not being rooted and grounded, as opposed to being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, as being having when things come your way, circumstances, diagnosis, whatever the case may be, those things when they come your way, they throw you off where you're standing. No, don't do that. I want you to be so rooted in Christ. I want you to be so grounded in the love of Christ that you may have the strength, the ability to know not about the love of Christ, but experience the love of Christ firsthand, that you may have the ability to know what is the breadth, what is the length, what is the height, what is the depth. And verse 19, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, our knowledge, that is. In other words, love that doesn't make sense. Crazy love. That's the kind of God love that God has for us. Crazy love. Love that surpasses knowledge. That is what is available to us. It passes understanding. It is too good to be true, but it is true. It surpasses knowledge, just like the peace that he gives, right? That's available to us. Peace that passes understanding. Peace that he offers us despite what our circumstances may be, as unfavorable as they may be. We're talking about love that demonstrated itself. It was not just talked about. God showed us. He showed you that he loved you, and that while you were still a sinner, far from God, undeserving of anything but condemnation, as a sinner, God, Romans 5:8, sent his son to die for you, for your sins on the cross. And on that cross, the perfect, sinless, spotless blood of Jesus Christ was shed to wash away and to deal with all that you needed to pay for. Romans 5:8. God doesn't want us to be aware of that love. He doesn't want us to just read about that love. He doesn't want to hear about that, us to hear about that love from someone else. He doesn't want us to just catch a glimpse of that love and have a moment, a flash in the pan. No, he wants us to have front row seats and a backstage pass. He wants us to taste it. He wants us to feel it. He wants us to know it and to see it with our own eyes, to be washed and overwhelmed by the amazing love of God. More and more and more, for this reason, I bow my knees to the Father. I want so much more for you. I'm burdened for you to experience more. But as awesome as those things are, all that stuff, those things, Christ dwelling and strengthening in your inner being, that's just a means to an even greater end. He doesn't just want us to be strengthened in our inner being. He doesn't just want Christ to dwell in our hearts, to rule and reign, to have the wheel, like Carrie Underwood says, to be blown away by the amazing love of God. That's all a means to a greater end. He says, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. In other words, I don't want you to lack for a thing. I want you to overflow with the love of God. I want you to be filled up. Remember Stephen? One of my favorite testimonies and heroes of the Bible is Stephen. Three times in a row, it says this guy is full when they were looking for a deacon, right? This guy was full of grace and power. He was filled up. And you know what? Then we see him go through some really terrible things. People were lying about him, saying that he was saying things that he didn't say, and all he was trying to do was help people. All he was trying to do was minister to people, and they killed him. But remember what it said? He said that he had the face of an angel. He was so filled up. Didn't matter what came his way, he was so filled up. It said he saw the face of Jesus. When it says he had the face of an angel, that means he was at complete peace, though the storm raged around him. How about you, brothers and sisters? Stephen's God is your God. My God. And the same fullness that was available to Stephen is available to us. This is what Paul is praying for this church, that you would be filled with all the fullness of God. It's a fervent prayer to the Father for fullness, that the believers in this church and as a church will be so filled up, and by God, that when the trials of various kinds came, they would consider it an opportunity for great joy, and instead of doubting and turn their backs on God and get angry with God, like we do. Amen, we do. He wants these people to be so rooted and grounded in Christ and the Word that when the storms of life come, it's not if they come, it's when they come. Can I get a witness? They come. And when persecution and trials and tribulations found those believers, just like they find us here today, when God called them to do things that involve sacrifice and maybe even suffering, they would stand firm. They wouldn't run and hide. They would weather the storm, that they would be faithful to their faithful God and his purpose for them as a church. This is a fervent prayer to the Father for fullness as an end. And just want to remind you, this is what Jesus wants for us, right? He says, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He doesn't want us to be burdened. He wants us to be blessed full. Because when God's people are filled with all the fullness of God, they bear fruit. Amen? They bear fruit and multiply. They do what God created them to do. They are who God created them to be. Just like in Ephesus, the word of God, the kingdom of God increases and prevails and God is glorified. But the fruit that we're talking about is summed up in the last two verses, verses 20 and 21. It says, God is able. I have to remember it. I can't find it in my notes. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly, far more abundantly above and beyond all that we might ask or think. And to him be the glory, brothers and sisters, in the church and in Christ Jesus, who is the head of the church. Listen, I'm telling you, when God's people, when you, brothers and sisters, saved by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, when you are who God has created you to be, when you let him fill you up, when you let him strengthen you in your inner being, and he wants to strengthen you in your inner being, and let me tell you, Jesus wants to rule and reign in your heart. He wants to sit on the throne. He's a jealous God. He knows that that's when you will be the happiest. That's when you'll be filled up. That's when, come rain, come shine, come hell or high water, you will stand firm, you will be rooted, you will be grounded. And God will be glorified because you will be doing, you will be so filled up and blessed and content, as my wife talked about earlier, and you will just be generous like our God, like Jesus Christ, and God's kingdom will be built and God will be glorified in the church. In the church, our church. And listen, there's strength in numbers. Listen, there's synergy. We can do more when we do it together. God can still use you as an individual, and I don't want to discount that. But I'm telling you, I am tired of hearing excuses and justifications from person after person after person about some church out there that I don't even know exists. And listen, I know that people have been hurt by churches that aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing. But all I can say is, brothers and sisters, though we are not perfect here, we have a heart to glorify God, a heart to be obedient, a heart to do more, because we love God and because we love the people that he loves that are outside the doors of this auditorium who are lost and who don't know Jesus. And we want them to know Jesus. And so we want to be about making him Jesus so that we can all glorify God together. It's gonna take sacrifice. So let's recall to mind the things that God has done here and in Smyrna and that he's doing all over the world, and let's trust him. And let's be willing to make sacrifices. It's worth it. Let's be willing to take steps of faith. It's worth it. Let's let God strengthen us in our inner being. Let's stop looking in the wrong places and let's look to God to do what only he can do. Jesus said, I will build my church, and he's been doing that. Let's let him do more, but we need to be obedient. We need to do what we're called to do. We need to go. We need to be his hands and his feet. We need to proclaim the word of God, the gospel that saves. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? The best is yet to come, and this is not prosperity gospel. I'm not saying it's going to be easy. I'm telling you, Jesus said, in this world you will have tribulation. I'm promising you it will be hard, but it's worth it hard, I'm telling you. The sacrifices and suffering that you make are worth it. As you go to that baptism celebration today, know that the sacrifices that you made, what you gave, how you served, you played a part in those baptisms. You played a part in the saving faith, the eternal destinies of those children, men and women. Let's trust God for more. And let's look and trust God for his glory and watch him do exceedingly and abundantly above and beyond all that we might ask or think, more than we can even imagine, and let's pray for more glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. As we close, I consider what Moses' testimony. Listen, they experienced the power of God. They watched him part the Red Sea. They walked through on dry ground. They watched all their enemies destroyed completely. And Moses, they experienced the glory of God, but remember what Moses said as God continued them on because he had more for them. The promised land was awaiting them. He said, if your glory will not go with this, God, I don't want to go. And that's how I feel right now. That's what I want from us and for us, for God. And for others who don't know him, who have not yet seen and tasted the glory of God, but who can.